When a new disease emerges, one of the first things that people want to know is who's at most risk, whether your newborn baby or asthmatic child or your elderly grandmother might be particularly vulnerable to this disease that we're hearing so much about every day. As the number of cases increases and scientists have started to get more reliable data about who's been affected, we're starting to get some answers. In China, one of the first trends to emerge was that men seem to be making up more of the cases and also more likely to die than women. The fatality rate there for men was 2.8% compared to 1.7% for women. And at first, this was largely put down to smoking rates being so much higher in men than in women in China. Around half of men in China smoke compared to just 1 or 2% of women. We've seen this trend mirrored in lots of different countries now, South Korea, Italy, Spain, countries where there aren't these huge differences between male and female smoking rates. So now scientists are starting to look at whether something different in the immune system's response between men and women. Older people are at greater risk from COVID-19. So if you look in the over 80s, the mortality for that group, based on the cases we know about, is about 14%. And that drops down to around 3.5% for people who are in their 60s, and then progressively less and less. So it's less than 1% once you get to under 50s, and vanishingly small chance for people in their 20s. Although the fatality rate is much, much lower in younger people, that's not to say that there's nothing to worry about. It's also not to say that there won't be some deaths in younger age groups. And that's because as you build up more cases, you start seeing those outliers, those really unusual cases where someone, even though they are young and healthy, have a really unusual and bad response to getting this infection. A lot of diseases follow what scientists call a U-shaped risk curve. The very youngest people and the very oldest people are the ones at most risk, and then it dips down in the middle. And I suppose one of the positive things of COVID-19 is that we haven't seen this, and that the youngest children don't seem to be at any increased risk of getting serious symptoms or dying. One thing that isn't really clear at the moment is why children aren't at risk, and whether they're still getting the infection and passing it on to the people but not getting symptoms themselves. COVID-19 is a disease that attacks the upper respiratory system and can also make breathing more difficult. So any condition that affects your lung health, things like asthma, COPD, there's also evidence that illnesses that affect your immune system, so things like cardiovascular disease, diabetes, any autoimmune disorders, that those also make you at greater risk and more vulnerable. It's definitely the case that healthcare workers are at greater risk of catching COVID-19. They're going to be exposed on wards day in, day out, and obviously that risk is even greater if people don't have the right protective equipment. It's possible that because they're exposed to a greater viral load, that they end up getting a worse version of the illness. Doctors and nurses have represented quite a lot of the deaths in some countries. In Italy, for example, there's been dozens of doctors who've died, even though they might not necessarily fit into those high-risk groups that we've seen in the general population. Pregnancy is also something that can affect how your immune system responds. But reassuringly, in this case, it doesn't seem that pregnant women are having worse outcomes or suffering worse symptoms. But because this is such a new disease and there's so much we don't understand about it yet, pregnant women are still being considered an at-risk group and being asked to take extra precautions. If you belong to one of those more vulnerable groups, then it's so important to make sure you self-isolate in the strictest way possible. And if you're not in one of the groups that have been labelled at high risk, it's still really important, both for yourself and other people, to follow the social distancing measures and isolation measures that have been laid out. But you could also help the more vulnerable groups by joining NHS volunteers, or perhaps helping out a neighbour or people who live near you who are unable to go out to the shops and do the normal day-to-day jobs.